would find this really hard to believe, but my actual birth announcement that my mother sent out in 1963 said, "Here she is, Miss America." Kind of weird, huh?
Hello.
Hello.
How are you doing?
Good to see you.
Ooh, you look pretty good.
Thank you. This is a real pleasure.
I have a best girlfriend, and she heard your song on the radio. Uh-huh. She called me and she says, "Have you heard Vanessa's song?" This is really, she says, "I was driving in my car. I had to pull over to the side of the road, girl." Turned around and went and got the tape.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah.
And our new Miss America is Vanessa Williams.
She's also the same friend that called me and said, you know, after this song had been on the charts for such a long time, she said, "I'm so proud of her." And we had this long conversation about, this is long before I knew I was going to interview you, about how proud we were of you because you seem to be a phoenix who's sort of risen from the ashes. Do you feel that way sometimes?
It's been a long haul, but I finally feel like the dust is settling and I'm able to be myself.
Look toward you when I open.
No, you can look that way. Just try to smile with your eyes closed.
I don't feel like I've made it or I've achieved a lot. I mean, because you know, reality slaps you in the face all the time. But I feel like I'm finally getting a chance to do what I like.
Here we go. Slates up. Roll playback. Camera, please.
That's great. And then come back
to the strand.
Yeah.
You do some great videos, girl.
Videos to me, making videos as opposed to me doing some choreography and acting, and I get to wear as many hats as I want to.
Look at the boys, not at the camera.
And lay back.
Just did a Jackson's miniseries, and I played Suzanne DePass, who gave me one of my first jobs as Josephine Baker in Motown Returns to the Apollo in 85.
You wonder how depressing it is to not have makeup on standing next to this woman. You know, I mean, it's bad enough, but there's like the vagaries of time.
I wonder what it was that made you, I don't know if it was belief in yourself, mm-hmm. but to withstand the, because I think what you went through was about the worst anybody has to, would have to go through. Publicly.
Maybe it is being a black woman, because we've had to withstand so many obstacles and barriers. I think that's one of the kinships that we all, you know, we've been surviving for hundreds of years. I also came from a family that my parents were educators, and, you know, there were no boundaries. You know, they said if you believe in yourself and you work hard, you know, there's no reason why you can't achieve whatever that is.
There she is. Miss America.
And the nation's first black Miss America has reluctantly given up her title.
Therefore, I do officially relinquish my title as Miss America 1984.
Let's start from the beginning. First of all, you enter the pageant, and it's sort of almost a fluke when you enter the pageant.
I mean, to get scholarship money.
To get scholarship money. When all across America, I mean, I've seen stories about it, read about it. There are these girls now, 7 years old, being groomed for the Miss America title.
Right.
Their parents have invested thousands of dollars in all of the, you know, Miss, you know, beeswax pageant and the Miss Sunflower, this and so. And then you just sort of enter as a fluke and you win. So what did it mean to you to win?
I didn't know what it meant. That's what was, I think, my biggest problem. I had no idea what an impact it would make that the first black Miss America would be chosen in 83. You know, it was the first time that I'd been at competition, so my beauty was never something that I marketed or targeted or used it, you know, my
or
talent was
about?
My
Vanessa,
talent was
Vanessa.
Always
what? When you look in the mirror though, Miss Blue Eyes, Miss Green Eyes, Miss you're one of the great. I mean, really, I was looking at you on the monitor. I said, the girl is just one of the prettiest people in the world.
Thank you.
So you have to, when you look in the mirror, I know, was there a time maybe, you know, everybody goes through that duckling stage.
I think I brought some duckling pictures for you.
Goes through that duckling stage. But was there a time when you looked in the mirror and you said, I'm kind of cute?
I guess it was, I mean, I've always had acne problems, and I was on tetracycline at 16. I broke my front tooth in fourth grade, so I always wore a cap that never quite, you know, would match my other teeth. Yeah. So I had, you know, I started to gain about 10 or 15 more pounds than I should have in high school. So I'm trying to think when I did blossom, probably when I got to college, and I was dancing every day, but my body was fit, I was on my own, and I felt like I kind of came into my own at that particular time. Okay. And now I look back at those pictures and think, man, you know, I look much better than now because I'm 29 years old. I think my kids have made me feel like more like a woman.
A woman.
A woman, whatever that is. And I feel much more relaxed and secure about my body, and I think
So what you're saying is, though, but you never sort of used the beauty or marketed it. You were accustomed to using your brains and your talent.
Right. Absolutely.
To get ahead.
Right.
So all of a sudden to be put in that competition with the standard of what American right. beauty is.
And to be labeled as a beauty queen, that's the toughest thing for me. You know, I grew up in New York seeing Broadway shows. That was my goal. And now when I go and up for these auditions with these famous directors, like, oh, you were Miss America in 1983, it negates everything.
Happy days are here again.
One of the things that shocked me, I didn't even know about this until hearing about this recently, is the response, negative response, when you first became Miss America, mm-hmm. from black people who were saying you were not black enough.
Well,
isn't that the thing? I've heard that a lot in my life,
perhaps.
Which just,
right, right.
I mean,
it's like you can't.
I look in the mirror.
Right.
You look in the mirror. There's right. this black face staring
right.
back at you. So
right.
who the hell are you if you're not
right.
black?
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. It's that was the initial thing. People that hadn't even seen the pageant and even heard me sing, oh, the reason why she won is because she has light eyes, and I heard one theory that they had rigged the lighting so all the black girls looked lighter than they ever had that year. I said, come on, did you even watch the pageant?
Yeah.
And that hurt me, you know, a lot because here I was, you know, being this representative that I had no idea I ever would be, but then being in Selma, Alabama, and having police outside my motel room 24 hours because I was black and getting death threats. So it's like, what, you're black enough to be hated by the Klan, but yet you're not black enough to be black.
Because they changed the lighting. I hadn't heard that one.
Yeah, so it was crazy, some crazy times.
Can you all hear me?
When all of the international attention surrounding mm-hmm. being Miss America hit, was the fact that you'd taken those pictures in the back of your mind, was that always there?
Yeah, it was like not a black cloud, but something that was gnawing. The thing that I was kind of safe is I never signed a release. So I
right.
said, well, they can't do anything anyway.
So in the back of your mind, they were there?
Yeah, but again, I thought there was a guarantee that, you know, since there was nothing signed, nothing can happen. But that's not the way the world...
Miss Naivete.
Right.
So when you, where were you? Do you remember when you first heard that they were coming out? How were you told?
I was at the Miss New York State pageant in July, and it was Friday the 13th.
Oh,
I got a phone call from a reporter.
I used to not be superstitious.
Yeah, right. I got a phone call from a New York Post reporter, and he said, there's a rumor from a very reliable source that you're doing a 10-page spread in Penthouse. Is that true? And I just, you know, froze, and I said, I have no idea what you're talking about. And he said, well, it's a very reliable source. And I said, I have no idea what you're talking about. And he said, well, I won't print it if you don't know it. So then I immediately called my lawyer. I said, I don't know what's going on. We got to find out. I went to Little Rock, Arkansas the following week, and that's when, I mean, I didn't even know what was going to be printed. I had no idea. No one had seen anything.
Uh-huh.
But the magazine wouldn't even tell my lawyer whether it was true or not. And then, you know, coming back home when the news hit, it was like, it was bigger than life from that moment on.
I would think knowing what little I know about you now, the hardest mm-hmm. would be to tell your parents, or was
yeah.
it?
That was the hardest, because you don't want to let down your parents. I mean, you know,
no.
as a kid, whatever age, you don't want to let them down. And I said, I don't know what's going on, but some pictures are going to come out of me, and I'm really sorry. And I started crying, and my parents said, you have nothing to be sorry about, and that was all I needed. And I said, okay, I can handle anything.
That was it? They didn't say, what kind of pictures?
No.
Why did you take the pictures?
No.
Your parents didn't say, why did you take the pictures?
No.
What
and
good
my
parents?
Dad said, I remember my dad driving me to my attorney's house. I said, well, Ness, you really blew it, huh? I go, yeah, Dad, I really did.
No. That is terrific.
Yeah.
I read, I don't know if this is true or not, because you could never believe it.
That's right.
Same me. But so tell me if this quote is correct, that you said for about 4 years you found it hard to even say your name. Is that true?
Yeah. You know, calling over the phone and giving your credit card number, whatever. Oh. Vanessa Williams. Oh, is this the Vanessa Williams that was the former Miss America? You know, you get attached to because I.
People are so kind, aren't they?
I know.
In 5, 4, 3, 2.
Hey, good morning.
Here we go. This is Soul of VH1, Current 1, Segment 6.
Okay, slide it.
Here we go. Nice and quiet.
We're ready. Let's
here.
Do it.
All right, quiet. Here we go.
Roberta Duncan. Runway, runway. Hi, I'm Vanessa Williams, and this is the Soul of VH1.
Wasn't there a time when you thought, it's over? Career's over?
No, there never was.
Never was that moment.
Even in the heat of it, I think I was certainly concerned about public, public response and self-esteem. That really played a big issue. But I knew that eventually, you know, it just made me stronger. One of these days, these people are going to be buying a record. One of these days, these people
you did?
Are going to be, yeah. You had to turn it around.
I can't wait to get home to you. I've got so much work to do. Work.
Great. All right.
Vanessa,
yeah.
Anything you need to do, please go and do it now. We're going to set this up and light it without rehearsal.
Oh, my God, I love this.
You have great, perfect chair.
How's having children changed your life?
It really puts things into perspective on a daily basis. When you don't get a part, you can come home to the loving arms of your kids and you forget about, you know, the miserable reading that you did for the greatest director in the world or whatever. It really makes, like, health and well-being the most important thing on a daily basis, because when they're sick, nothing else matters.
Want to go inside?
Yeah.
Okay. You see the tomatoes? That's like Papa's garden, huh?
Are you the kind of parent your parents were?
I try to be, now that I've grown up and see what a great job they did. You know, my dad read to me every night of my life until I was like in eighth grade when it got time.
I heard that when you had the first time you had a friend to stay over, you're about 12, yeah. Your dad comes in the room.
Three of us, dad, not tonight, no.
No, dad.
Yeah. But, you know, education, I remember sitting at the dinner table, my brother can attest to this, but, you know, Black History flashcards. Who's Harriet Tubman, when was she born, what did she do? You know?
Really?
Yeah. And it's all the stuff that's in the back of your memory that when you play, like, Trivial Pursuit, it all pops up and you...
You got it.
Right. Exactly.
Bye, Daddy.
Bye.
Bye, Daddy.
Do you like being called wife?
I work with my husband, so I don't really get to be called a wife a lot. It's usually we're a team working together. So I think for him, a lot of people said, oh, that's Vanessa Williams' husband, which to him sometimes is frustrating, as opposed to me being Ramon Hervey's wife.
How instrumental was he in getting you through that really difficult time after the dethroning?
Mm-hmm. Extremely. I mean, I'd say... metaphorically, you know, he was like a knight in shining armor, really, because I was in distress and he came in on, you know, on his white horse, took
as
care of
the
press conference. As the publicist.
He's the one handled that first news conference.
Exactly,
yeah.
and arranged it.
It's public knowledge that you all have had some counseling, so I'm not asking this question to get pry into your business, but I would think, first of all, the time that you married and under the circumstances that you met and everything that goes into building a relationship and the age that you were,
right. That
it would be very difficult because...
Yeah, it's been stress from day one, and it's just a high-stress marriage. And
do you think you'll really always be married? You think you'll always be married?
I like being married.
Yeah,
I do. I like having that sense of security, having, you know, someone to, you know, to rub your cold feet on at the end of the day.
But you see him all the time, right? Your husband, all the time. So, because he's your manager, he's there all the time.
Right.
There must be days when you want to say, okay, I've had enough of you. Come on, darling, yeah. I've had enough.
We get into those days.
Really?
And, yeah. I don't know whether we're going to be working together for the rest of our marriage anyway, because there comes a point where you have to say, do you want a marriage or do you want a partnership? Because you know, it's really tough to balance the two.
What?
She
said, wait up, Oprah.
You know, one of the, I think, universal spiritual laws is that everything that happens happens in everybody's life to bring them to their highest good.
Mm-hmm.
Even the dethroning, you think?
Yeah, it made me much stronger. I mean, I know nothing is, nothing can faze me now. Interesting, I just sang for the president in June for at the Ford Theater, and we were at a function afterwards at a women's museum. And I was wearing the black Giorgio Sant'Angelo dress that I had performed in, standing on the buffet line. I get to the buffet where the dishes are, and I grab my dish, and a woman comes over to grab it out of me and thought that I was there to serve her. And I said, boom, doesn't matter how big you get, I'm wearing the same dress that I just performed in. She didn't even take the time to look up to see who it was. She just assumed that I was a black girl and I was there to serve her. And I said, you know, that just hit me like a ton of bricks. It doesn't matter how large you think you are in your head. And I tell that story all the time because, you know, it makes success all relative. I mean, I certainly have everything that I want, which is a wonderful family, the vision and the means of a career where I have control, and some great friends that I've made over, you know, the past 10 years in the business. And so financially I'm not there yet, creatively I'm yet to get there, but I feel like I'm definitely on my way.
Sometimes the snow comes down in June.